Hi everyone. Is my screen visible? Okay. So, how are you guys? In 2 days we have CAT. So, how are you feeling? Are you all prepared for the exam? Insomniac, this Dixit Thakur. Okay, that most of the people are throughout the year, especially engineers. Tensed, positive, scared, okay, mixed type of reaction, excited. I don't know who is excited for exam. Okay, so yeah, let's first come to this question and then we will talk about the queries. Okay. So how many of you tried this question? I'm not sure if my screen is exactly visible or not, but I have already posted this question in the group as well as I have posted this question 2 days back in our daily DLR event also. So this question's discussion was pending. So this we will do today. So did you already attempt this question? And maybe we'll talk about the queries later once we are done discussing this particular set. So how many of you attempted it and were not able to solve it? Tried sir, but pura nahi kar paya. Screen is visible. Okay, that's fine. Anand also tried and didn't get it. Dikshit, I guess you solved it. I saw your first questions comment. I'm not sure if you solved later all the questions or not. Solved it, Samarth. Okay, good. Others didn't even try, because if you haven't tried, it's totally pointless to see the explanation without even trying. Anyway, so tried but pura nahi hua solved. Shubham Gupta, Rishi Raj solved. Great. Okay, so we will start discussing this problem first. Okay, the question says, a person purchased a bag once. Okay. Solved, but with iterations of values of 10 rupee note took time. All right. Okay, so some hit and trial will of course be used. It's not exactly that very simple. Okay, so let's come to the question. A person purchased a bag, a bat, and a pen drive for total amount of rupees 1019. Okay, so it is given in the question, bag plus bat plus pen drive equal to 1019. This is given. Okay, and he had money in notes of only three denominations, that is ₹1, ₹2 and ₹10. Okay, and he had a total 180 notes. So suppose I am assuming he has X 1 rupee note, he has Y 2 rupee notes, and he has Z 10 rupee notes, then the value of X plus Y plus Z is 180. This is the one equation. And other thing what they are saying is he used all his money, means whatever this money is, he used them all in purchasing these items. Which items? Bag, bat, and pen. And the price of bag, bat, and pen was 1019. So they are saying that this was for 1, this was for 2, and this was for 10. So X 1 rupee note will be of what value? X rupee, Y 2 rupee note will be of 2Y value, and Z 10 rupee note will be of 10Z value. It's like if Z is 5, there are 5 notes of 10 rupee notes, then 10 into 5, that is 50 rupees, right? So, and this sum is total is equal to 1019, because using all these, he is buying this bag, bat, and a pen drive. So this is exactly 1019. So are these two equations clear or not as of now? Screen is not clear, please help. I mean, maybe you can try going to HD mode for the video, or maybe check your internet connection. All right. So are these two equations clear so far? Because these two are the most important thing which we can derive from the initial data that is given. Another thing they have given is the bag is least expensive. Okay, so this is least expensive, whereas the pen drive is most expensive. This is most expensive, so this would be middle. So it's like increasing order, cost wise. Okay, so the cost wise it is increasing. All right. Okay, now coming to the points which we have given, which we are given is in purchasing each item, he used at least 2 and at most 35 notes. Okay, so this you will have to take care of while taking any values, that at least each or at least 2 is used and at most 35 notes of each denomination is used for each and every item. Okay. The another thing is the total number of rupees 2 notes used in purchasing the bat and bag put together was 54. So now they are giving some data for 2 rupees note or 1 rupee note or 10 rupee note for item wise. Okay, so now from here we know that we will have to form a table where we can keep a track of the fact that for each of the item, how many 1 rupee, how many 2 rupee, and how many 10 rupee notes were spent. This second clue is clearly giving us this idea. So that's why a table you can see here that I will form. Okay, so just let me write the values. First of all, here I will write for bag, here I will write for bat, and here I will write for pen drive, so PD. Okay, and here I will write total values. Okay, total, and here I will write for 1 rupee note, here for 2 rupee note, and here for 10 rupee note, and here also total. Total. Okay, now what will be the differences between both the totals? Okay, I will let you know. Okay, so here we are going to write nothing but 1 second. Yes, number of 1 rupee note which were used to buy bag, here for bat, here for pen drive, and so on for everything. Here we are going to write this total in terms of rupees, how much it comes, and here we will write in terms of number of notes. Okay, so this value is nothing but number of 1 rupee notes used to buy bag, bat, and pen drive. This will come out to be as X, as we have taken that as X number of 1 rupee notes. These total is nothing but 1 rupee note, these total is nothing but 2 rupee notes, and these total are nothing but 10 rupee notes. So these are X, Y, and Z what we have assumed here, and this total is 180. This we know. For if we write value wise, as of now we don't know the values for bag, bat, and PD separately, but we know the total value as 1019, so we'll have to figure out the values. All right, let's read what it was saying. Yeah, the total number of rupees 2 notes used in purchasing the bat, rupees 2 and bat means this, and the bag means this, put together was 54. So they are saying sum of this plus this is they are talking about number or the amount, the total number. Okay, so sum of this plus this is 54, the number of notes This is clear. Let's read the next instruction. The worth of the bag and the bat put together was 635. So bag means this and bat is this. Okay. So their cost put together is 635. So, but we don't know which one is what amount exactly, but we know that total they have spent 1019 in buying all three, and for two they have already told us the price as 635. So what will be the price of pen drive? Of course, the left out one, that is 1019 minus 635. What will this value come out to be? 9 minus 5 is 4, 11 minus 3 is 8, 9 minus 6 is 3, 384. So one thing for sure, the price of pen drive is 384. Clear? This is clear so far. Okay, now next point we will read, and these two sums to be 635, which is quite obvious. Okay, the number of 1 rupee note used in purchasing the bat was 15. Bat 1 rupee note is 15. Okay, this value is 15 they have given, and that of rupees 10 notes used in purchasing the pen drive was 35. So pen drive rupees 10 notes is 35. So this value they have given as 35. Okay, so instruction number 4 I have already used entirely. Instruction number 3 also I have used. Okay, let's move ahead. For instruction number 2 I have yet not noted. I just know that the sum is 54. For instruction number 5, the number of 2 rupee notes and the number of 10 rupee notes used for purchasing the bag, means this and this they are talking about, were prime numbers. Okay, so these two are prime numbers they have mentioned in the question's instruction. Okay, but the number of rupees 2 notes and rupees 10 notes used in purchasing the bat were not prime numbers, means this and this, these two are not prime numbers. Okay, so this is the extra information which they have given, and that's all. Nothing else is given. You don't know anything else. You have to figure out everything. Okay, now if I see the questions, they are asking what is the number of rupee 1 notes used in purchasing the bag. So it's a TETA question, so of course CBD is not an option. It means we are 100% sure that a particular value will be coming out for this. So it's not like we'll be getting lots of cases. Okay, a particular answer we should get for this. And similarly for question 2 also, it is quite obvious. Total number of rupees 2 notes the person had, how many rupees 10 notes did the person use to purchase the bag. So exact values we are getting. Okay, so there will not be lots of cases. Now for fourth question, you can see, if it is known that the number of rupees 2 note used in purchasing the bag is 19, then what is the difference? Now since they have given if condition and then they are asking, it means the questions will not come out as exactly one solution. If there was exactly one solution, why they would say as if this is the case, then they would have directly asked what is the difference. But it means the difference will not be same. There must be at least two cases where different differences were coming and they are asking for a particular case. So this also we know, the solution which we will get will not be exactly one solution, but it will not be lots of solutions either. For these things we will be getting exactly one solution for this part. Inside some cases will be there. So let's see. Okay, now if we start solving, where should we start from? So the key point to start would be this, because this is the only item for which we know the total. Okay, so since we know the total for pen drive, that is 384, and we also know 10 rupee notes used were 35. So 35 10 rupee notes means 350 rupees. 350 rupees they paid using 10 rupee notes. So how much is left? 384 minus 350 will be 34 rupees, right? Now this 34 rupees they have paid using 1 rupee note and 2 rupee notes, which how many are there we don't know. So as of now I will assume A and B to be the number of 1 rupee and 2 rupee notes, and the value we know is A plus 2B is equal to 34. Okay, this is what we know so far. Now we don't know anything else, so let's make cases for this. Okay, so lowest number can be how many? A can be 0? No. A can be 1? No. A can be 2? Yes. Why? Because in the question it is specifically mentioned that for each item, each note is used at least 2. So A can be least 2. When A is 2, what will be the value of B? When A is 2, 34 minus 2 is 32 by 2 is 16. So when A is 2, B is 16. Okay, I am writing the possible values of A comma B. So when A is 2, B is 16. What will happen when A is 3? Can A be 3 first of all? When a is 3, 34 minus 3 is 31, and 31 by 2 b will become fraction 0.5 something. So no, a cannot be 3, a can be 4. When a is 4, 34 minus 4 30, 30 by 2 is 15, then b is 15. So like this it will go on. Then a will be 6, then b will be 14, and so on. It will keep on going until when, until b value is 2, because b will not go to 0 until b value is 2. So when b value is 2, then 2 2s are 4. Now 34 minus 4 is 30, then a value will be 30. So these are the possible values of a comma b: 2 comma 16, 4 comma 15, 6 comma 14, and so on till 30 comma 2. Okay, is it clear so far? So far is it clear, or any doubts? Please answer. So if in generally if I write a value, which value? Okay, b's value is ranging from 2 to 16. This we can see b value is in the range of 2 to 16. Okay, all right. Now we know that this bag plus bat, these values sum as 54 in the point one they have given. Okay, let me write a few more things. They have given that for bag rupees 2 and rupees 10 notes were prime, so I am writing these as p1 and p2. Okay, now these are p1 and p2. For bat we know that the sum they have mentioned in the first point, no, not first, second point, the total number of rupees 2 notes used in purchasing the bag and bat was 54. So if this is p1 number of notes, so this will be 54 minus p1. And from point number 5 we know that this 54 minus p1 value is something up non-prime. Okay, because only these two are prime and these two are not prime. So this is this value, and this I will write as q, which is also not a prime value. Okay, now coming here, for 2 rupee notes we know that the value of b is in the range 2 to 16. Okay, it came in the range 2 to 16, and these two are 54. P1 plus 54 minus P1 is 54, which was given here also 54. So what is the range for Y? Range for Y we can simply say as 54 plus B. 54 plus B means 54 plus minimum is 2, that is 56, 2, 54 plus 16, that is 70. So 56 to 70, this is the range of B, which are the possible values of, sorry, range of Y, which are the possible values of Y. 56 to 70 only. No, it cannot take values more than 70, it cannot take values less than 56. So far is it clear? So at least some data we have found. Okay, now how to proceed after this? What I will do next, how to figure out? So if you notice, we have written two equations in the beginning. These two equations we got from the data given. Why they are given? It would be of some use at least, right? So let's use this. We now know the range of y, okay, and we have two equations where three variables are there. Okay, so what I will do is, let's subtract equation 2 minus equation 1, because RHS for equation 2 is greater, and x will cancel, then we will get only two variables. So let's try to do that. X minus x cancelled, 2y minus y will give y, plus 10z minus z will give 9z. This value will give what? Equal to 1019 minus 180. Now 1000 minus 100 is 900, and 900 minus 80 is 820, and plus this 19 means 839. So this value is 839. This is the equation. Y plus 9z is 839. Okay, now from here I know that y's range is 56 to 70, so I can try to get the range of z also, right? Okay, so if I write the equation in the form of z, z is 839 minus y upon 9, correct? So now we know that whatever term comes in numerator will be a multiple of 9, then only it will be divided by 9, and z will be integer, because z is integer, z is the number of notes, z cannot be a fraction. Okay, so we know that this y value should be so that this numerator 839 minus y is a multiple of 9. Now how to check that? we can simply use the digital sum method. You know that digital sum is 0 or 9, then it will be a multiple of 9. So 839 is 8 plus 3 11 plus 9 20. 20 means 2 plus 0, that is 2. So here digital sum is 2 for 839. So digital sum of y also must be 2, so that 2 minus 2 becomes 0. And as I told, if the digital sum is 0, it will be a multiple of 9. So now in this range, you just have to figure out what are those values whose digital sum is 2. So let's check 56. 5 plus 6 is 11, means 1 plus 1, that is equal to 2. Bingo. So the very first value we found, that y can take the value as 56. Now if you have any doubt, you can simply use the calculator and subtract 839 minus 56 and divide it by 9. You will get an integer value, that is 87. You can check if you have any doubt. But I need not even do that. From digital sum, I can figure this out, that this is 56. Once y is 56, what can be the other value of y? Other value will be 56 plus 9 only. Then only it will be a multiple of 9. So 56 plus 9 will be 65. Digital sum, if you don't know Mehul Sharaf, you can Google. Okay, digital sum is nothing but, suppose if a number is 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, just add all those digits. Keep on adding, like from 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, you will get 7 plus 6, 13 plus 5, 18 plus 4, 22 plus 3, 25. So you got 25, then again add it. 2 plus 5 equal to 7. You will have to keep on adding it until you get a single digit number. That is digital sum. Okay. Anyway, so here digital sum was 56. So one number, digital sum was 2. So from here we got 56. Another value will be 56 plus 9, that is 65. Then the next will be 65 plus 9, that is 74. But that goes out of the range because y value is only 56 to 70. So 74 is not possible. So from here we figured out that the possible values of y are only 56 and 65 and not the complete range 56 to 70. There are only two possible values of y. Is it clear? And for those two values of y, 56 and 65, you can find the z value. When y is 56, 839 minus 56 upon 9 is z. So that time when y is 56, z is 87. And when y is 65, just do it, 839 minus 65 upon 9, then you will get 86, because one more is subtracted and divided by 9. So it's like minus 9 by 9, so minus 1 only, so 86. If you cannot figure out, you can simply divide and check. So these two are the possible values of y and z. Is it clear so far? Okay, let me do the next step also. Since we know the sum of x, y and z, now if you know the values of y and z, you can easily get the value of x, right? Let me remove this. Okay, so since the sum is 180, from here we can figure out the x value. So this was 87, right? So 80 plus 50 is 13. So 130, 137 plus 6, 143. And the sum was 180, right? So this will come out to be 40 minus 3, 37. So x, y, z. This value, for the first case, it will be 37, 56, and 87. This will be the first value. And for the second case, it is 65 and 86. So 8 and 6, 14, 140, 146 plus 5, 151. So 150 plus 30 is 180 minus 1, so 29. So this is 29, 29, 65, 86. These two are the possible values of x, y, and z. Now, and you can see for the first question when it was asking what is the number of rupee 1 notes used for purchasing the bag, means purchasing the bag. Okay, this it was first question number 2. What is the total number of rupees 2 notes that the person has, means y value it was asking. And y value we are getting 2 as of now, so we can still eliminate one case. This we know from here because the answer is not CBD, it's a theta question. Okay, so the work is yet not done. You still have to figure out some more things. Okay, so till here, at least tell me, is it clear or not how we got the XYZ two cases from lots of cases? Someone was saying for Z, they had to do lots of hit and trial or something to get the value now, but I have only got two values for Z. Okay, is it clear so far? Then we will move to the next step. Now, if you notice what and all we have used for the first equation 2 and 35, of course, that is something we have to maintain throughout the set. Second question, rupees 2 notes and purchasing. Okay, this 54 wala we have already taken in count. So second instruction is already used. Anytime, whenever you are solving the set, this is how you will have to track that this instruction is already used. So how to solve ahead, which instruction you have not used so far, of course that you will have to use to solve ahead. So third instruction was the worth of the bag and the bat, 635 wala part, this we already used. Then only we figured 384 and used all this. Fourth wala part is the number of rupee 1 notes used in purchasing 15 and 10. Okay, so 15 is here and 10 rupee notes is 35. 35 we used, 15 we have not used so far, but we have mentioned already. Now fifth is number of 2, okay, primes, these two are primes and these two are not primes. This is only we have given. Maybe this we can utilize to solve the question. So let's see how we will do that. Okay, so there are two cases as of now. So this is what we can try using. Okay, how we can try using. Let me think one second. Okay, so we will get two cases, right? All right, so when we take the first case, 37, okay, let me do one thing. Let me make a copy of this so I don't mess with the table. I will keep another copy here. Okay, I hope this equations we have already used as, yeah. Okay, so I will keep one copy here. So out of two, if one case is eliminated, I can start working on the other one. All right, y equal to 65 eliminate ho jayega. We will see, Kaushal, abhi to, as of now I cannot see it being eliminated, so I will not comment on it. Let's solve ahead, then we will see. So let's take the first case when this is 37, this is 65, and sorry, this is 56, not 65, this is 56 and this is 87. Okay, this is 87. Now if this is 56, P1 and 54 minus P1 means B is nothing but 2, because these two sum is 54. So this will be 2, then only total is 56. Now this is 35. Okay, when this B value is 2, what is the value of A? We know that A plus 2B was 34, if you remember. A plus 2B was 34 because this is 350. So 34. Okay, now B value is 2, means 2 2s are 4. So A value would be 30. Okay, so when B is 2, A value is 30. So this A we figured out is 30. We can remove the variable name so it doesn't confuse us. This is 30, this is 2, this is 5. All right, now what else? Okay, so now we know that total number of 1 rupee note is 37. But here you can see total number of 1 rupee notes used to buy the pen drive is 30. Total number of 1 rupee notes used to buy the bat is 15. So even, and the lowest for bag will be 2. It cannot be 0, it cannot be 1. Lowest is 2 at least. So it should be at least 30 plus 15, 45 plus 2, 47 at least. It can never be 37. Here we are getting total number of 1 rupee notes as 37. So this is a contradiction. So this case is not a correct case. Now we get the exact case, that is 29, 65 and 86. I hope this is clear. So in fact, 65 wala case bachega, 56 wala eliminate ho raha hai. Okay. So now we know for 100% sure, because this case is eliminated, so only one case is left. So this is 29, this is 65 and this is 86, and from here itself 65 I can answer for question number 2, which we are looking for. Answer for question number 2 will be 65. Here only I can answer without even solving the complete set. I can say the answer for question 2 is 65. Okay, now we have to move on with this case. Now since this is 65, these two sum is 54, means this is how much? 64 plus 1, so this is 11. B value is 11. Now when this is 11, what will be A? A plus 2B is equal to A plus 2B when B is 11. So 2 into 11 is 22, is equal to 34. So A is how much? 22 plus 12, so A is 12. Okay, so A value we got as 12. So this A I replaced as 12. Now this is 12, this is 15. Now 15, 10, 10, 20, 25 plus 2, 27. So total is 29, so this is 2, right? 2 plus 15 plus 12 is 29, and this also satisfied the condition of at least 2 and at most 35. So this is a correct case. Okay, Kaushal, ulta bol diya tha, koi baat. Fine. So now, apart from these two, these two and these two we are clear with all. All right, we know the rest of the values. Okay, now let me get some space here to solve ahead. Okay, now can anyone tell me what should be the next instruction which we should use? Now I guess most of the instructions we have already used. Only a few instructions are left. I think exactly one instruction is left, wo prime wala, right? So we have no other option but to make cases for rest and check. Okay, now let's try to make cases for what? P1 and 54 minus P1. We know that sum of these two is nothing but 54. This sum is 54, and least it can be 2 and maximum it can be 35, and P1 is a prime. So I will try to write all the possible values of P1. Okay, all right. So if I start writing from the maximum value, 35 is not a prime, 34 no, 33 no, 32 no, 31 yes, 31 could be a prime. And what is the sum? Sum is 54. So if this value is 31, what is the next value? 31 plus 3 is 34, 44, 54, so this is 23. So 31, 23 is one combination. Another combination after 31 will be 29, is the next lower prime. If this is 29, then this will go to plus 2, that is 25. What could be next? 27, no, 25, no, 23. So minus 6, so this will be plus 6, so this will go as 31. And 21, no, 19. So minus 4, so this will go as plus 4, that is 35. Now it cannot be more than 35, so there is no point in going lower than this. So these four are the possible four values of P1, but correspondingly we have to also check that this 54 minus P1, or that is this value, is not a prime. So this case is eliminated because 23 is a prime. This case also eliminated because 31 is a prime. Now we are getting two cases, 39, 25 and 19, 35 for these two. Okay, now we are getting only two cases. Now we will have to work on two cases until we eliminate them or whatever. Okay, so these two cases we will have to deal with. All right, so again let me go back to two tables so that I can use both the cases. Okay, just give me a second, I will remove this and write those values. All right, so in one of the table I will take them as 29 and 25, and one of the table I will take as 19 and 35. Okay, now we don't know which one is correct or both are correct or what is the case. Okay, now we have still not found this P2 and Q value, but we know that these are nothing but prime. P2 is prime and Q is not prime. Okay, now this total is 86, this is 35. Okay, so I don't need this because I have already entered in the table. This space instead I will use to figure this out. Okay, so this is 86, this is 35. 86 minus 35 is 6 minus 5, 1, 8 minus 3, 5. Alright, so sum of P2 and Q is nothing but 51. Sum of P2 and Q should be 51. Okay, and again the same cases we will have to use. 2 to 35 it should range. So I will again start from 35, 34, 33, 32, 31. One value is 31. Then what will be the other value? 31 plus 20 will make 51. If other one is 29, then this will be 22. If after that it will come 29 minus 6, 23. So this will be 22 plus 6, that is 28. Again the next lower prime will be 19. So this will be 23 minus 4, so 28 plus 4, that is 32. And can we go lower than this? Okay, this is 51, so let's try. This is 32 only. Next lower prime is 17, so this will be 34. Okay, now 16, 35, 15, something something. Okay, now it will be greater than 35. So these are the five cases we have got so far. Now which one we can eliminate? Since we know that this value is not prime, so if it is prime we will have to eliminate, but we cannot see any prime values here, all are even. Okay, so we cannot eliminate anything as of now. Then what will you do to figure these value out? You are getting five values. Okay, so what we can try is put them here and check. There is one more condition pending which we have not checked so far, that is the prices of bag is less than bat is less than PD. So let's try putting this and check. If you put 31 here and this 20 here, sorry, not here. For this P2 and Q value, if you put 31 here and this 20 here, 31 tens are 310, 19 twos are 38, 310 plus 38, okay, and plus this value is 2, that will come out to be 350. This sum comes out to be 350, and this sum is 20 into 10 is 200, and plus 35, right? 35 twos are 70, and plus 15, this comes out to be 285. This is contradiction because they have told bats price is more than bag, but we are getting less. So that's why this case 3120 will not be possible. Now similarly, you have to try all the cases and see. 2922. If I put 29 here, then one second. Okay. If I put 29 here, this will become 290, and if I put 22 here, it will become 220. So here only this has got lead of 70. Now can it make up that lead of 70? 19 and 35. So how much lead that will make up? 19 plus 1 is 20, 15 plus 1 16. Okay, so 16 to the 32 lead this has maintained, made up, and 13 here. So still not 70, right? So this case is also not possible. I am just trying to compare. If you have any doubt, of course, you can put and calculate it. 23 and 28. 23 and 28, well, here they have a difference of 5, so 5 tens are 50. Can they make up 50? 19 and 35, okay, again. 20, 15, 16. 16 to the 32 they have make up here only. 1 second, 23 and 28 it is. So if you check 23 plus 5, 230. Let's just calculate it and get done with it. 230 plus 19 into 2 is 38, plus 2 is 270, and this is 28, right? So 280 plus 70 plus 15, so that will give 365. So this is more. This is more. So this case is possible. Okay, this case is possible, this is not possible. Now try 19 and 32. Okay, when you try 19 and 32, so 19 tens is 190 plus 19 into 2 plus 2, this will come out to be 230, and this 32 will give 32 into 10 is 320 plus 35 to the 70 plus 15, this comes out to be 405. Now again, this will violate the fact that BAT's price is less than pen drive that was given. But here we are getting 405 as BAT and 384 as pen drive. So this case is again not possible. Okay, so again, this fourth case is not possible. And again, if you put 34 here, so this will be 340, which is even more than 320, which we put last time. So again, this will come as more than 384 only. That's why this case will also be not possible. So in this one, the only case that is possible is 23,28 for P2 and Q. Alright. So I will just replace them. Is this clear or not? I put all the values just to check. And we figured that out of these 5, only one value is possible. That is this as 23 and this as 28. Now this we have checked in this case. In this case, we are still yet to check. So, alright. So if I... let's start checking here also. Okay, so if you check the similar way, one second. Okay, so here also you have to follow the same thing and check the similar way. Just put these values and check. So if you put 31 here and 20 here, so you will get 310 plus 29 into 2, that is 58 plus 2. So 58 plus 2, 60. Okay, this in order to avoid, I will write them at once. So 29 to the 58 plus 2, 60. This one is 60. And 25 to the 50 plus 15, 65. So there is a difference of 5. This is on a lead of 5. Now, here it is 31, here it is 20. This is on a lead of 110 that they cannot cover up. So of course, the first value is not possible. Like this, you can directly compare. Okay. So first case is not possible for this also. Second one, 29, 22. So this one had lead of 5 earlier, and the first one that bag took a lead of 22 plus 770. 70 minus 5, 65. Again, this is on a lead of 65. So that is not possible because bat should be having lead. So this is also not possible. 23, 28. Now this is 23, this is 28. Earlier bat had a lead of 5, and 23, 28 again lead of 50 they have taken. That is lead of 55. So this case is possible. Now just confirm if this is not getting higher than this. 28 tens are 280, and plus this 65 will make 345, which is still lesser than 384. So of course this case is possible. this case is possible 23, 28. So this is possible for sure. Now let's just check other cases. Are they possible or not? 19 and 32. So of course this is BAT is greater than BAG, but is it getting greater than PD also? When you put this as 32, 320 you will get here from 10 rupee notes, and plus 65 will make it 385, which is greater than 384. So this case will be eliminated, 385. So this fourth case eliminated, and similarly for the similar reason, fifth case also eliminated because it is even further more. So here also in both the cases for BAG and BAT, 10 rupee notes we are getting as 23 and 28 only respectively. Okay, so I guess most of the things we have filled. Now if you want total prices also you can fill. So total for BAT is, in both the cases it will come as different, I believe. Yes, so let's fill this case. For BAG the price is 23 into 10 plus 29 into 2 plus 2, that is 290. And this will be 280 plus 25 to the 50 plus 15, that is 345. Now you can just confirm if your calculation is correct or not by adding them all. 290 plus 345 plus 384, how much it comes? 1019. Perfect. So this is correct. Now similarly here also let's just do it. 230 plus 19 into 258 plus 2, that is that will come out as 270. And this other value will come as 280 plus 70 plus 15, that is 365. And let's just confirm, 270 plus 365 plus 384, it comes out as 1019. So yes, so now we got their total two possible cases, this and this. Okay, now let's read the question number one. What is the number of 1 rupee notes in purchasing the bag? Bag, 1 rupee note, here we are getting 2, here we are also getting 2. So the answer for first question is 2, as I told. For the first question, we should get the exact answer. So the answer for first question is 2. Second question, we answered long back that it was 65. Third question, how many 10 rupee notes did the person use to purchase the BAT? BAT and 10 rupee notes. 10 rupee notes and BAT is here 28, and here also it is 28. So the answer for third question, from both the cases, we are getting 28. So this is the answer. And the fourth question, it is asking if it is known that the number of 2 rupee notes used in purchasing the bag is 19. Bag, 2 rupee notes is 19. So this case is what they are talking about. Here it is 29. So not this case. So now you have to consider this case. Okay. In this case, they are saying that what is the difference between the cost of the bat and cost of the bag? Cost of the bat is 365. Cost of the bat is 270. 270 plus 100 is 370. 5 less. So that is 95. That's why I told, here we must be getting two answers from which we are deciding one case. So we are removing this case. So from the beginning only we knew there will not be a single case. There will be more than one case, but there will not be lots of cases because from first three questions we were getting exact answers. So is this solution clear now? How I solved it? I didn't do anything extra, anything fancy. I simply used all the instructions which were given. Everything I just tried to connect piece by piece, and it's all done. Okay, so anyone has any doubt so far here in this question? All right, if not, we are done with the questions. And maybe we can move to queries if you are having any. If you have any queries related to CAT 2017 or whatever, you can ask. It's now only 2 days are left. It's time consuming. Well, if that's what you think, in CAT all the questions will be time consuming for you then. Anyway, it's DILR, it's not quant that you can get done in 10 seconds, 20 seconds, or maybe 1 minute. Here you will have to spend 5-10 minutes, sometimes even 15 minutes if the set is difficult. But the main thing is learning. The main learnings here was No matter what the question is, how difficult it seems, if you use the information piecewise and logically, if you keep on connecting, you can solve it. You can solve any questions. So that was the key point which I wanted to explain here. These sets like these should be round two or leave alone sets. Gaurav, you can say this was a round two question. In round one, you will get much other easier question. But suppose cat ka dimag fir gaya, and just in case they have given all the eight difficult sets, then there is no other option. You will have to solve the difficult set anyhow, whether you take 15 minutes or 20 minutes or what, but you will have to solve. Of course, the cutoff will be lower that particular year when all the questions are difficult. Maybe one who solves two or three sets correctly will get 99% IELTS. So, but the main thing is you will have to solve. So attempting a set or not depends on mainly two factors. One is your own capability, what kind of set you are comfortable with. So that set you will try to go with in the first round. Second thing depends on the LOD of the paper. How are the other questions in the particular exam? If other questions are easier than this set, then of course you will go with them. If other questions are even difficult than this set and you are not even able to make any sense or comprehend the other sets, then there is no point going for them. Instead, you will go for this. But if we compare it to the other normal mocks, in those scenarios, I believe this would be a round two question. Okay. Logically easy to understand and doable. Okay, you are talking about this set. So, I mean, you were saying about how to strategy to assure 90 percentile in all three sections. Well, that depends. If someone is coming today and he has not prepared anything, and if he is asking for a strategy that he can follow in 2 days and crack the cat with 90 percentile, that is not possible. But I'm certain you are not that case. You must have already prepared, right? So whatever you have prepared, it doesn't matter. Whatever score you are getting mock right now, what you should do is revise all the mocks that you have taken so far. So whatever hard work you have done this complete year, that shouldn't go in waste, because aage padhte jaoge piche bhulte jaoge, that is quite obvious, happens with everyone. So first thing you should do is revise everything. Even mocks open karke, try to see the solution so that it comes in your mind at least once. And then you might remember it. The logic might click you if similar question you see in the CAT exam. So that is one thing. The next thing is, if we talk about 90 percentile, it's very easy to get 90 to 95 percentile. It's very, very easy, provided you have done your basics, you know the concepts, and you keep your calm in the exam. Because if you notice last year, four sets, whoever would have done with good accuracy, he would have got 99 percentile. And in order to get 90 percentile, probably if we compare the difficulty level of the previous years, last 2 years, if the paper comes of similar difficulty level, then doing three sets with 100% accuracy will surely fetch you 90 percentile. And doing three sets means only 20 minutes per set. I am saying it's a 60 minute paper. Even if you scan through the paper in the starting first 4 or 5 minutes, out of 8 sets, if you are weak in DLR, what will be your strategy? Your strategy will be to clear the cutoff, score 90 plus. That's right. Okay. So out of 8 sets, first thing, choose 3 easy sets, which you can see that, okay, these are somewhat familiar set. I don't have to do R&D in the exam that what is this, what is that, I have never seen such type. You will have to break your head. If you are doing some set for the first time, it might be a problem for you. But something which you have already seen, suppose you are good at arrangement questions or distribution question and you see such type of questions, that should be your first target. So my main point is, out of 8 sets, you decide your 3 sets which you should be attempting and try to do them first. Even if you take 20 minutes per set, you should be able to do those 3 sets in 1 hour. Okay, only the most important point is accuracy. Focus on your accuracy, that shouldn't go low. Try to keep it 100% if possible, because in DILR it's very rare that you will make mistakes. If you have comprehended it wrong, if your logic is wrong, then all the 4 questions will be wrong. It's very rare that one question is wrong. Maybe because there were, you missed a few cases. Sometimes it happens, you missed a few cases or you marked it wrong, then only 1 or 2 questions will be wrong. Otherwise, mostly either complete set is correct or complete set is wrong. That's what happens in DILR. So I would say go for 3 sets which you can comprehend, which you can crack and score 36 marks in them. Now, if some time is left, of course, you can go for 4th or 5th set. That totally depends on how fast you are. But your first target should be to go for 3 sets. Anyone who is aiming for 99 percentile, maybe their first target should be 4 sets. Solve 4 sets with 100% accuracy once. So 15 minutes per set. If you are done with that, good. Then you can move for 5th or 6th set. Otherwise, no. Then just finish this particular milestone, set your milestones, 4 sets in an hour if you want to get 99 percentile. Yeah, of course, you should be in a position to, if a paper comes easy, you shouldn't settle down with 4 sets. That you will, of course, figure out once you do the 4 sets. If you are able to do it quickly, then you have more time, of course, you will move ahead. Scoring 85 percentile in mocks is decent. It's quite, so of course, you know the basics. 85 percentile is not a bad score. In CAT, of course, you can score more than 95 also, provided you maintain your calm. Don't get stuck in a set. Of course, see, the main thing is nobody gets stuck in a difficult question. If you are not able to comprehend, you will not waste your time. You will simply skip it. People usually get stuck in an easy set. That is the fact. You can see the set is very easy. Okay, I have done similar set, but why I'm not getting the answer? You will try rechecking. You will try remaking the cases while keep on doing that. After some time, when you see the timer, okay, 15 minutes are gone and I have yet not reached the solution. That is how you get stuck in a question. So everybody is stuck in an easy set. Nobody is stuck in a difficult set. So what I will say is after 5 minutes, you are not able to reach to the solution, or at least make a roadmap in your mind to how to reach the solution. If it is troubling you, then leave it. Even it is very easy question, of course, you can come back to that particular set later. What happens is, if you are stuck somewhere for a longer time, there is very little probability that you will be able to solve it at that very particular time. Instead, you will be wasting your time. Now, if you move to some other set, you solve that particular set, or one or two sets, if you solve, you will gain confidence. Now, if you come back to that set which you were trying earlier, you will be able to figure out the mistake which you were doing earlier. Somewhat, your mind will get clear after solving two sets. Somewhat, confidence will be boosted after solving two sets. And then you will be able to solve that easy question which you were missing out earlier. But continue solving the same set until you are able to solve is not a solution. That is called getting stuck. And sometimes it might happen that it was a difficult set which appeared to be easy, which appeared to be very short, but it was very logical one, and it was kind of a pit hole that CAT has given for the people that who do not identify that for them the CAT for them the exam is missed. So that is possible. You shouldn't be the guy who gets fallen in that pit hole. So skipping is an art, and you shouldn't feel ashamed on skipping a question. It's a management exam. It's not IIT JEE exam. It doesn't require technical knowledge. It doesn't require you to know all the things. It only requires you to know how to manage stuff. If 8 sets are given, a few easy, a few medium, and a few difficult, you should manage how to avoid those difficult sets, how to attack on those easy sets, and how to get maximum marks. Then only. That's why CAT is true test of management, true test of manager. All right, any other query? If nobody has any queries, I will just drop out then. Alright, so I guess no more queries. So fine. Kuch motivational lines bol do, Jaydev Trivedi. Yaar, ab main Sandeep Maheshwari to hoon nahi ki koi motivational lines, motivational tips do. But motivational point line dene ka koi matlab hi nahi yaar. Everyone has started their CAT journey thinking of something. Some may be thinking about salary, some may be thinking about a good wife. Some might be thinking about a good career. Some would be thinking about their parents, like they have given us something, now it's time to give them back something. So for that, you need to stand on your own feet. So sabke different reason hai CAT karne ke. Okay, so just think about that reason. You will get your motivation. That's what I will say. Shubham Kumar, in VRC, if getting two possible choices and not able to come to conclusion whether I should take a risk, answering closer option or gut feeling option. Well, Shubham, what I usually do is when two close options are there, I try to read the passage and then figure out which one is wrong. Instead of finding which one is correct, I will try to figure out which one is wrong. Okay? Because from whatever data is given in the passage, if you think like this way, from this data, which option I can eliminate? Okay, try to eliminate that option and whatever is left out, mark it. In 90% of the cases, I will mark the question after eliminating two options, whatever two are left. From that, whatever I feel like, I will mark it. I just go with them. But if you don't do that, I think you will not be able to mark any of the inference-based questions, because all the inference-based questions, you will last with two options. Other, if you keep on skipping it, you will never be able to mark it. Only you will attempt direct questions, which are very few. So you will have to go with that. That's why practice is important for such types, and proper analysis is also important. So you can revise all the mocks where you have got inference based questions, what mistakes you have done, what is the solution given in the mock, what you were missing, so that you can you might not be able to totally eliminate this case. Like, you will not get negative, I will not say, but you can improve your thinking process and you will get more correct than you used to get earlier. So just revise and yes, go for that attempt after eliminating two options. However, if the in some of the questions, like in IMS, I have seen all the four options appear to be correct, and in that case, if you are taking a risk of marking any one option, then that is the biggest blunder that you can do. Okay, so don't do in those type. Okay, Ashutosh is asking, should we go one by one in VRC or solve the RCs first? Okay, Ashutosh, as an answer for your question, I will say play on your strengths. I guess I have told this before also. So play on your strengths. If your strength is RC, go for RCs first. If your strength is VA, go for VA first. All right. So it's not like you need to go in order only. Now, RCs are the major chunk and most of the people are good in RC except inference based. And verbal is a problem for most of the people. I will just say most of the people, because what I have mostly observed, one who is good in VA is the one who has read a lot. Their grammar is good. They can solve PJ is good. They are good in vocabulary. So they are pretty much good. If you are good in VA, then you must be good in RCs also. That's what I have observed. And those are the guys who are usually scoring more than 97 or 98 percentile consistently in VRC. So keeping them aside, you need not take advice in VA from me. For others, I will say you should focus more on RC, because those are they consist of the major chunk of marks there. So you should of course focus on RC. Try solving those six questions RCs first. Once you are done with them, now solving all the five RCs in one go might give you a headache. So you need a break. So after solving three RCs, which were of six questions, you can move to VA. Skip para jumbles if you are not good at it. Skip grammar if you are not good at it. Attempt para summary, para completion, odd one out. And then again switch back to the RCs, those three questions RCs. You can try this strategy. Okay. If you have understood the RC, then you can easily eliminate options, as Anuj sir said. Just read each word in the options clearly, because sometimes just one word is a trap. Of course, mostly one word or one line will be a trap. That's what happens. Very minute observation is required to identify that. Tone of the passage and suitable title for the passage often troubles me. So Shubham, if you know what troubles you, try to skip such questions, because most probably you will get negative there, or even if you are marking it correct, you will be skeptical about your answer, and that might cloud the judgment which you are going to take. That might make you make a mistake because you are not confident enough. Even if you are going to mark A, and you will like think twice, okay, I always whatever I mark I get wrong usually in mocks, what if I am doing mistake here also? And then you will get double minded, and then if you mark B or whatever, if this is the case, or you might take longer time to decide. So if this is the case, I will say these particular type of questions you skip, or at least keep it for round 2. Once you are done solving all the question and timer has not ran, then you can think of attempting it. Okay, otherwise skip it. Any more questions? Okay, I guess no more questions. Can we wind it up? Okay, so if you get any question later, of course, you can post it in the group or inbox me, not the type which I posted earlier in the group. Okay, so all right, I guess we are done. Fine, so revise everything and go with a light mind. Do not take a lot of pressure that you have to score this and you have to score that. Leave about scoring, okay? Focus only on what? Focus on clearing the cutoff first. As I said, try to solve four sets in DLR first and quants. If you are going for quants, focus mainly on first 25 questions. Your aim should be to do 15 easy questions. Identify those 15 easy questions which are given in CAT in the first 30 minutes, and in the first 30 minutes, you should be able to go through all the 34 questions in quant. You should, if you are done with seeing all of them. So what I'm saying is basically see all the 34 questions, solve, identify, and solve 15 easy questions in the first 30 minutes. In next 30 minutes, even if you take medium level of question, and even if you solve, even if you give 3 minutes per question still, you should be able to solve 10 questions. So 15 plus 10 is 25 questions. So that's what should be your target. If you are very slow in quant, then of course you can adjust the target. You can make it 20 or 21 or something like that. But this is the ideal case, which I will say if anyone who is aiming 99 percentile in quant. All right. And of course, you should be adaptable depending on the difficulty level of the question. You should be increasing or decreasing your attempts. But accuracy should not fall down. That you should keep in mind. क्वांट में केसेस वाले क्वेश्चन में कितना टाइम लगेगा अब वो तो पता नहीं यार. दैट डिपेंड्स ऑन योर स्पीड, दैट डिपेंड्स ऑन द क्वेश्चन. इफ तुम्हें इशू है, ऑफ कोर्स यू कैन स्किप और यू कैन कीप इट फॉर राउंड टू आल्सो, बिकॉज दिस इज अ वेरी जनरल क्वेश्चन. कितना टाइम लगेगा, दैट टोटली डिपेंड्स ऑन द क्वेश्चन. टीटा में रीचेक करना चाहिए. ऑफ कोर्स यू शुड रीचेक इन टीटा. ओके, रिगार्डिंग टीटा, इफ वी टॉक, जनरली द आंसर्स फॉर टीटा विल बी इन इंटीजर. इफ इट इज नॉट इन इंटीजर, इन द ब्रैकेट दे विल बी मेंशनिंग, राइट द आंसर करेक्ट टू वन प्लेस और टू प्लेस और थ्री प्लेस ऑफ डेसिमल. इफ इट इज मेंशन, यू विल नो योर आंसर इज गोइंग टू कम इन डेसिमल्स. ओके, इफ इट इज नॉट मेंशन मोस्ट ऑफ द, then you should be sure that your answer should be coming in integer. So whenever you are doing calculation, that time only you should just recheck in the calculator if whatever you have done is correct or not. Like sometimes it happen, if you are typing 555 into 73, by mistake you missed a 555 into 77 something you typed, and because of that your final calculation or whatever you are doing, you got wrong in the intermediate part. Then after that, whatever you solve, you will get wrong only, right? And then coming back again, tracking where you have done mistake, that is very much time taking and it will only waste your time. So what you should do is whenever you are doing a calculation, just recheck it. And if in theta question at any point of time, if you are getting a decimal value and in the question you can see in the bracket it is not given that right, enter the value two places to the decimal or something, then there could be a possibility that you have calculated wrong. So just recheck in those cases. There itself, instead of going till last and then again rechecking, try to recheck the calculation in intermediate steps only. Okay, questions of the type where you need to find the number of pairs or numbers which satisfy some condition, that also theta questions. These are normally risky questions. Of course, it is true. Well, that also depends on how much you have practiced, how much confidence you have. If someone is scoring 70 or 80 in quants consistently, then I don't think such questions will bother him. He would be very much used to it. However, if your scores are hovering between 40 to 60, then These are the questions you might think of avoiding in first round. If in second round other questions are way more tougher, then only you should think of attempting it. So as I have said, play on your strengths. If there is something which bothers you, why would you like to go against that? Instead, find some other easier ones, and trust me, in CAT you will find plenty of quant questions which are easier. You should be able to solve 28 to 29 questions if your speed is good, with 100% accuracy. So main thing is focus on accuracy. Even if you solve 25 questions with 100% accuracy, that is 75 marks raw, and the skill score will be of course around 80 to 85. That is way more. All right, that will be kind of 99.8 or 9% high. So that is very high. So what I am saying is focus on accuracy, play on your strengths, whatever you are comfortable with, just attempt those and you will do good. Just do not panic, do not get stuck. These 3-4 points I keep on saying every time. Do not get stuck. This is the biggest mistake which I know 10 or 20% of the people who will be taking CAT will be doing it, and this is what will be lower down their scores, and I don't want you guys to be one of them. So I keep on saying this again and again. Great. Okay guys, so all the best for CAT. If you have any more queries or any more issues, of course you can post in the group or inbox me. All right, if I'm free, I will reply of course most of the time. And what else? Okay, for tomorrow I have some plans that I will discuss tomorrow only. All right, so chalo, good night, revise, study, or enjoy whatever you want, totally up to you. Mostly I would say do not take stress in last 2 days. Eat well, sleep well, rest, because you need to be in your full potential on that particular day on 26th. All right, okay then, chalo, good night everyone, bye bye.